Hello there! Today is a special day for me, because I get to talk about a topic that I'm really passionate about, welding in space. More specifically, methods that would allow for welding of larger pressure vessels and structures in the vacuum of space. Well, maybe not this one. Because until we master that, the human presence in space will be confined to life in small connected cylindrical modules, always limited by the size of the rocket's payload fairing. Small modules are not only hard to live in, but also inefficient in very many different ways. So let's look at the brief history of welding in space and take a deep dive into a method that might make the colonization of space possible. We all love good science fiction. Odd, amazing stories placed in the future, full of large habitable space stations and starship fleets. However, what we have today is the International Space Station. Don't get me wrong, I think it's a marvel of engineering that has been continuously occupied for 20 years, but its design is centered around connecting a bunch of small pressurized cylindrical modules together. These modules and their pressure vessels are fully built on the ground, so they need to be launched into space as a single piece. The diameter of all ISS modules is smaller than 4.4 meters. Do you want to guess why? Well, it's because that's the maximum width that can safely fit into the space shuttle's cargo bay. Even the first private space station in progress, the Axiom station, will have modules of the same 4.4 meter diameter, even though the last space shuttle flight was almost 10 years ago. Well, to build their modules, they contracted Thales Alenia, a French-Italian company that built around 40% of the International Space Station, and that is the size of their tooling. A private space station is really exciting, but it's still a far cry from my favorite science fiction stories. Assembling small cylindrical modules is also inefficient with respect to mass and protection against micrometeorites and orbital debris, because of the large resulting surface area. But how do we change this paradigm? We humans have to learn how to weld pressure vessels and other large structures in the vacuum and microgravity of space. So, what have we done so far and what have we learned? Well, there are a few things. The first ever welding in space was done in 1969 by Soviet cosmonauts aboard the Soyuz 6. This mission carried a 50-kilogram remotely controlled test apparatus called Vulcan, which was placed in the vented out habitation module while the crew was in the return capsule. This device was made by the Ukraine's Patton Institute of Electric Welding. It contained multiple samples on a rotating table and three different welding methods for testing. First was a low-pressure constricted arc with hollow cathode, which failed due to not being able to concentrate enough plasma-forming gas in the low-pressure environment. The second experiment was a low-pressure arc with consumable electrode, which was successful after the gas was pumped with high enough rate. And finally, the third Vulcan's welding experiment was for electron beam welding, which welded different samples of stainless steel, aluminum and titanium alloys of thicknesses between 1.5 and 2 mm. This would have been a success if it wasn't for the issues with the smoothness of rotation of the table with the samples. Also, there might or might not have been an accident during the experiments when Vulcan almost burned through the pressure vessel of the habitation module. In response to Soviet demonstration of Vulcan, NASA tested an automatic electron beam welder aboard Skylab in 1972, but only for cutting and melting. This experiment discovered a major difference during the solidification of the metal due to the different flow of the molten pool between 0g microgravity and 1g on Earth. On Earth, when you have a hot molten droplet in vacuum, evaporative and radiative cooling causes the surface to cool down faster, so it becomes denser. Having higher density, it flows down, while the hotter center will start going up to the surface due to its buoyancy. There will be this pretty rapid convection process, assuring that it is well and uniformly mixed at the end. In microgravity, buoyancy does not work, and the denser colder surface does not go anywhere. Instead, much weaker surface tension is the main driver of movement. The colder part of the surface has higher surface tension, which pulls the cold region to the top of the droplet, creating a cold pocket with high temperature gradients. This is a slower process with less mixing, and might result in larger weld microstructures with slightly different properties. The third device in space in 1984 was the Universal Hand Tool, again designed by Ukraine's Patton Institute, but this time it was intended to be handheld and manually operated. Look here at Svetlana Savitskaya welding during her EVA. This is such a badass picture. Because electron beam welding produces powerful X-rays, the welder's operating voltage had to be limited for the safety of the cosmonauts. It could only weld around 1 millimeter thick pieces of metal. The universal hand tool went through a lot of different testing in space, and after the breakup of the Soviet Union, NASA asked Russia if they can analyze the returned welding samples. When they got them, NASA concluded that the majority of welds were of high quality. In 1989, NASA built and tested a laser-based device that flew on the zero-g plane, the Vomit Comet. It was a very low-power device, capable of welding only 1/8 of a millimeter thick stainless steel, but it was enough to notice the difference in the welds done on Earth and microgravity. In the late 90s, NASA realized the gaps in their knowledge of electron beam welding and decided to get back in the game. Both for political and practical reasons, they contracted the Ukraine's Patton Institute, who built them a significantly improved version of their, at the time, 15-year-old universal hand tool and called it International Space Welding Experiment. It had 5 different gun attachments for 5 different purposes. It weighed around 5 kilograms and the payload was cancelled before the flight. And to conclude the complete history of welders designed for space, the latest contribution comes from the Ukraine's Patton Institute again. Their creatively named new electron beam gun, built in 2018, is a greatly improved version of their manually operated designs. It is lighter, smaller, and more powerful. It has 2.5 kilowatts of power and can weld up to 6 mm thick aluminum or 4 mm thick stainless steel. For example, the aluminum pressure vessel of the ISS Columbus module is only 2.6 mm thick, so it could be used for repairs. There are many commonly known welding methods used on Earth, but not very many people worked with or even heard of electron beam welding. And yet, looking at the history of space welding devices and experiments, electron beam welding is by far the most prevalent. Why is that, and why is it so barely known? And most importantly, what is it? Electron beam welding, as the name suggests, uses a beam of high-velocity electrons to fuse metals together. When the electrons hit the metal, their kinetic energy is converted to heat. What I find super interesting is that in principle, there is a very little difference between the electron beam gun for welding and an old-school cathode ray tube monitor or television. The difference is in the density and the velocity of the electrons, and that instead of metal, in the television, the electrons are hitting the fluorescent screen. To get a beam of high-velocity electrons, first, free electrons are created in the cathode. To do that, the cathode is heated up, which increases their kinetic energy until it is high enough to escape the metal lattice that they were locked in. These electrons still have very low kinetic energy, so they are accelerated by a very strong electric field between the cathode and the anode to speeds between 30 and 70% of the speed of light. The field is also formed in such a way that creates a bundle of electrons traveling in the same direction near the axis. After the electrons leave the anode, they need to be focused to a single spot where we want to weld. This is done by a series of coils that form a focusing electric field. A good analogy would be how a camera lens focuses light. Electron beam welding is surprisingly a very mature method. The first practical welding machine was developed in 1958 in Germany. It was, somewhat famously, used from 1970s to weld the whole wing carry-through structure of the F-14 fighter jet together. This is possibly the most important structural piece of the plane that transfers the loads from the wings to the fuselage. It was made entirely out of 33 different titanium alloy pieces and put together with 70 individual electron beam welds. Its assembled length was almost 7 meters and the total length of the welds was 46 meters. Electron beam welding can be used for a wide range of applications, from extremely small and precise pieces like sensors on the Mars Curiosity rover's drilling arm to large applications like welding blades to the gas turbines. It can weld steel pieces 30 cm thick with a single pass, and most of the weldable metals, from aluminum to Inconel. It can even weld multiple different metals together. But if it is so capable, why isn't electron beam welding widely known, and why is it so rarely used in the industry? So let's address the elephant in the room. Electron beam welding must be done in high vacuum environment. If not, the electrons would be hitting the air molecules and the beam would quickly get dispersed. For industrial use on Earth, it means that a vacuum chamber is needed, and it needs to be at least as large as the welded piece. That makes the equipment very, very expensive. After each piece is welded, the chamber needs to be repressurized, its door opened, the welded piece replaced by a new piece, the door closed, and air evacuated again. That takes a lot of time. So, as a result of being slow and expensive, electron beam welding is only used for low-volume specialized cases where other solutions are not viable. But, as NASA, Soviet Union, and you already realized, none of these limitations apply in space where you are already surrounded by high vacuum. Its major disadvantage disappears, and what we end up with instead is a welding method with some incredible capabilities. Its weld penetration depth is precisely controllable, simply by regulating power. The same device can weld pieces fraction of a millimeter thick or 30 centimeters thick if it's powerful enough. This is a video of an 8 centimeter thick cylinder being welded in a large vacuum chamber. Welding is done with a single pass and the welding speeds are very high. During the electron beam welding research for F-14, they were welding 5 centimeter thick solid chunk of heat-resistant titanium alloy at 1.2 meters a minute. Distance between the electron beam welder and the welded part can be as high as 75 centimeters. The long distance makes it easier to weld in areas that are not easily accessible. This welding process has efficiency above 90%, meaning over 90% of input electricity is transferred to the welded material in the form of heat. This is important not only because it saves power, but also because there is a less waste heat that needs to be dealt with. How much power is needed for welding a given thickness is really hard to generalize, but I think it's very safe to say that for regular aerospace-grade aluminum 2219 that a lot of rockets and space station modules are made of, you should not need more than 4 kilowatts of power per centimeter of thickness. It has the smallest heat-affected zone from any welding method due to its extremely narrow beam and deep penetration. High-voltage machines can achieve a depth-to-width ratio of up to 25 to 1. That means that only a small amount of material went through physical change due to high temperature, preserving more of the original material's strength. It is a so-called autogenous welding process because it melts and fuses the base metals together without any filler material. That is really advantageous in space because you have no filler material to run out of. It is also best used on square butt joints, where you can just place the gun perpendicularly to the weld. And finally, it can weld almost any weldable metals, and it's also the best choice for welding two different metals together. Looking at this list, if I could dream up a perfect welding method for my future space station, electron beam welding would check all the boxes. There are of course other welding methods that can be used in space, but their potential seems very limited. Laser welding has much shallower penetration, problems with the laser being reflected from shiny metals, and is much less efficient. But it might be a great candidate for repairs and welding by astronauts inside the pressurized spaces. Friction stir welding, which is used for Falcon 9 and all rockets from United Launch Alliance, could theoretically work in space, but it would be very impractical. It needs custom, tremendously strong and heavy fixtures, a backing plate for the backside of the weld, and leaves a hole at the end that needs to be filled afterwards. There are a couple of drawbacks for electron beam welding as well. The requirement for high vacuum that we mentioned earlier is not really a problem for space welding, as long as we are not planning to weld inside of pressurized spaces. What is a major problem is a large amount of high-energy X-rays being emitted when welding. X-rays will not only mess up your cameras, but also your astronauts. It is the main reason why the power and voltage were kept so low for the hand-operated welders. The last disadvantage I see is also related to astronauts. Due to the very narrow electron beam, the welding must be done very precisely. And that's a hard thing to do when wearing pressurized spacesuit and hard-to-bend gloves. So we have a well-proven welding method with excellent and universal capabilities. The only downside is that it might be dangerous to astronauts and difficult to handle. So I guess here comes my rant, because the solution is obvious and the lack of development in this area is frustrating. Why not robotic welding? Put the welding gun on the robotic arm. Car manufacturers do robotic welding from TIG to laser with great success for decades. Or even better, make it into a tool attachment on a walking robotic arm, similar to Canada Arm 2 or European robotic arm on the International Space Station. Imagine what kind of progress and new design directions would become available if there is a proven concept of walking electron beam welding arm. Being able to move across the outside of the space station and weld individual pieces of modules together would open so many new possibilities. It would be possible to launch modules which would be assembled on orbit into shapes and sizes that are not limited by the rocket's payload fairings or the necessity to survive the G-forces during the launch. I want the battle room from Ender's Game, and I want it now. Anyway, the closest work to this, which is in progress, is Busek's Soul, the satellite on umbilical line. It is supported by NASA's Small Business Innovation Program, and it's a small teleoperated satellite under 10 kilograms of mass, which is always connected to the parent spacecraft by umbilical line. That way, it does not need its own power generation, it just needs the electron beam loader and enough attitude control. I think it's a step in the right direction, as long as it can operate precisely enough. Finally, I want to highlight contributions of a person who gave the world the opportunity to learn about electron beam welding in space. Do you know what the first Vulcan experiment in 1969, the Universal Hand Tool, the International Space Welding Experiment, and the new electron beam gun from 2018 have in common, except all being products of the Ukraine's Patton Institute of Electric Welding? Let me introduce you to Borys Jevenovich Patton, who worked on them all. Famous for his works in electric welding, he became the head of the Institute of Electric Welding, founded by his father, at age of 35. At the age of 44, he became the president of National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine, a position that he would hold for the next 57 years. The author of more than 1,000 publications, recipient of many Ukrainian and Soviet honors and awards, including the first ever awarded Hero of Ukraine medal. He died in August, 101 years old. Like him, we need to keep pushing for scientific and engineering knowledge for the betterment of humanity. Thank you for watching, and if you liked it, please subscribe. I make videos roughly once a month, and I don't want you to miss it. Are you curious about why SpaceX switched to a different material for the Starship SN8? Or do you want to know everything about protection from micrometeorites and orbital debris? Well, I have you covered on this channel.